Now that we've learned everything about quadratic equations, let's start solving some questions. The first question we have here is actually a question based on higher order equations, right? It's not quadratic, but a higher order equation. This is a ninth order equation. Question is to find maximum number of real roots. Whenever you have maximum number of real roots, the way we'll solve it is using Descartes' rule, right? What does Descartes' rule tell us? In f of x, which is what is given to us, x raised to 9 plus 5x raised to 8 minus x cubed plus 7x plus 3, correct? In f of x, the number of maximum number of positive real roots is the number of sign changes in f of x, and the maximum number of negative real roots will be the number of sign changes in f of minus x, correct? So we have f of x here. Let's check the number of sign changes. So 1 and 2, you have 2 sign changes here. So, 2 sign changes means maximum 2 positive roots, correct? So, we have maximum 2 positive roots. Now, for negative roots, we need to do f of minus x, right? Make sure that whenever you're writing this equation and checking sign changes, it's always in descending powers. Here, it was already given to us in descending powers, right? Check the powers of x. They should always be arranged in descending powers. If it is not, then just correct it to arrange it in descending powers. So, to find maximum number of negative real roots, we'll check f of minus x. F of minus x means all the odd powers will become negative. So, you just need to see this line. Whatever is an odd power, make it negative. Whatever is an even power will stay as it is, right? Odd power, just sign will change. Now, if you see number of sign changes, you have 1, 2 and 3, correct? 3 sign changes. So, that means maximum 3 negative roots. Right? Now, real roots can be either positive or negative or 0. That's the only other option, right? Is 0 a root of this equation? No. How will you make that out? Check the constant. If there is no constant, only then 0 will be a root. Here, we have a constant, right? You see this constant 3. You see this constant 3, which means that 0 cannot be a root. 0 cannot be a root. So, 0 is not a root. If there was no constant, then 0 would be a root. So, maximum number of real roots is 2 positive and 3 negative. Total will be 5. 2 positive, 3 negative. Total will be 5. That's the answer. Very simple. So, whenever you have a higher order equation, you need to find out the maximum number of real roots. Use Descartes' rule, right? We are not sure that there are 5 real roots. 5 is the maximum number of real roots, right? In case of positive roots, 2 are the maximum. You can see in case of positive roots, 2 are the maximum number of positive roots, right? So, they could be either 2 or 0. We know we have to reduce in multiples of 2, correct? Because complex roots will always occur in pairs. Similarly, maximum number of negative real roots is 3. So, it could be either 3 or 1. So, the maximum number of real roots is 5 in this case. Question here is to find out the minimum possible value of p squared plus q squared, right? P and q are the roots. So, p squared plus q squared is nothing but p plus q the whole square minus 2pq. Correct? Why am I writing it this way? Because sum of the roots, this is nothing but sum of the roots. This is nothing but product of roots, right? Sum of roots, you know, is minus b by a. Product of roots is c by a. Now, it's simple. So, we know minus b by a is going to be, right? Minus b by a is going to be this. A is anyway 1, right? So, this is going to be alpha minus 2 the whole squared minus 2 into product of roots, right? Product of roots is c by a, right? So, minus alpha minus 1. Correct? That is what this is. So, this is nothing but, if you simplify this, you will get alpha squared minus 4 alpha plus 4 plus 2 alpha plus 2. So, I'll write it as alpha squared minus 2 alpha. Now, I want to make it a, this is plus 6, right? I want to make it a perfect square. I want to make it a perfect square because the question is minimum possible value. You will see what is the advantage in making it a perfect square. Minimum possible value is the question, right? So, we'll make it a perfect square. How will I make it a perfect square? I can write this as alpha squared minus 2 alpha plus 1 plus 5, right? Instead of the 6, I'm writing it as plus 1 plus 5. Now, this is a perfect square. This is alpha minus 1 the whole square plus 5. Why did I do this? The advantage in making it a perfect square is, what is the maximum value? We are dealing with only real numbers here, right? No complex numbers. So, what is the minimum value that a square can take? 0, right? For real numbers, squares can't be negative. So 0 is the minimum value. That means for alpha minus 1, the whole squared, your minimum value is 0. This part is 0. This part is anyway a constant 5, right? So 0 is the minimum value of alpha minus 1, the whole squared. So this part is 0, minimum value. This part is anyway 5. So the minimum value of the entire expression will be 5. So whenever you have questions on minimum value and you see a quadratic, basically make it a perfect square plus some value. Make it a perfect square plus some value like we did here, alpha minus 1 squared plus 5. So that the perfect square, you know the minimum value it can take is 0 and the other part is the constant. That's how we get minimum value as 5 over here. Okay, we need to find a quadratic equation. This is nothing but a question based on transformation, right? Half of reciprocal. So first we need to find out a quadratic equation where the roots are reciprocals, and then we need to find out where it is half, right? Reciprocal means how do we do it? Interchange C and A. Cx squared plus bx plus a, right? Done. That is where they are reciprocals. Now they are half. That means basically, right? So here we got, this is nothing but roots are 1 by alpha and 1 by beta, right? Now they are half. So basically you're multiplying it by half, or you're dividing these roots by 2. If you divide roots by 2, what do you need to do to x? You will multiply by 2, right? So in place of x, we'll put 2x. Everywhere in place of x, you put 2x here. So this will be 2x the whole squared plus b into 2x. Don't forget this whole squared. Don't forget the whole squared, right? 2x the whole squared plus a. So this will be nothing but 4cx squared plus 2bx plus a, which is your option B. Correct? It's a simple question based on transformation, right? When we are doing reciprocals, we interchange c and a. That's what we did first. Reciprocal, so interchange C and A. That is what we did. Second was half. Half meaning the roots are getting divided by 2. So we'll replace X by X multiplied by 2, right? We do opposite. Whatever is happening to the root, we do the opposite of that to X. So if roots are becoming half, we'll make X as 2X. That's what we did here. In place of X, we put a 2X. Remember, when it is squared, don't write 2X squared. It will be 2X the whole square, right? So C into 2X the whole square. That's how we get 4CX squared plus 2BX plus A. This is a direct question. Quadratic equation is given to us. Ratio is given to us, right? We know when a root of a quadratic equation are in the ratio m is to n, mn b squared equals m plus n the whole square into ac. Right? Now, if you look at your equation, you can find values of all of this. B is not given, so b will be as it is. M, this is given as 3 is to 2, right? So m is 3 and n is 2. So this will be 3 into 2 into b is b only, so b squared. This will be 3 plus 2 the whole squared into a is 12. You can see a is 12 and c is 5, right? 12 into 5. Right? You simplify, you will get b is 5 root 10. Right? This 6 will get cancelled. This will be 2 times. 12 is 2 times 6, so you will get a 2 here. So basically, you will get 25 into 10. B squared is 25 into 10. You take root of that. 25 root is 5. 10 root is square root of 10. So you will get 5 root 10. Which is option C. It's a direct question. Very easy question. You know this formula, you'll directly get the answer. Right? You know the formula, you'll directly get the answer. Question 5. It's given that graph of a quadratic equation crosses the x-axis in two distinct points. Graph of quadratic equation crosses x in two distinct points. What does that tell you? Graph is like this, right? Crosses x in two distinct points. Upward facing because a is positive. This means nothing but d greater than 0, right? Crosses it at two distinct point means there are two real roots, which means d is greater than 0. That's it. The question is very easy now. What is d? D is nothing but b squared minus 4ac, right? In this question, b is minus 4, a is 3, and c is 2m. You can see that clearly, right? A is 3, b is minus 4, c is 2m. That's why you get this. Now just calculate b squared minus 4ac. So you will get 16 minus 4 into 3 into 2m should be greater than 0. So you will get 16 is greater than 24m, or m is less than 16 by 24, which is nothing but 2 by 3, which is option A. Very simple. It's basically nature of roots, right? When it tells you, this is, we saw four types of questions, right? This is the type which is nature of roots. Nature of roots means we check the value of D. As simple as that, right? It tells you, it's not directly given to you that both roots are real. How is it given to you? It is given that the graph crosses x-axis at two points. From that, you can automatically deduce that it means both roots are real. right? Or D greater than 0. This is nothing but a question based on nature of roots. Again, a question based on nature of roots, because you need to find whether the roots are imaginary, real, equal, or whatever, right? Whenever it's based on nature of roots, you know D, right? We know the four types of questions. This is the question based on nature of roots. Nature of roots means you need to calculate the value of D, right? How much will D be here? B squared, that is 2P minus 2P the whole squared, minus 4 into A is 1 into C. C is P squared minus Q squared minus R squared, right? This is 1, right? So this is A, this is B, and this whole thing is C. That's how we got this, A, B, and C. Now simplify, you will get 4P squared minus 4P squared plus 4Q squared plus 4R squared, right? Just open out this bracket. 4P squared and 4P squared are going to get cancelled, right? So what you're left with is 4Q squared plus 4R squared. Can you be sure that this is going to be greater than 0, equal to 0, or less than 0? You can 100% be sure that this has to be greater than or equal to 0, right? Because P, Q and R are all real, which means Q squared and R squared have to be positive or 0, have to be greater than or equal to 0, right? So this part is also greater than or equal to 0. This part is also, both these parts are greater than or equal to 0, right? 4Q squared and 4R squared, which is why the sum is greater than or equal to 0 means roots are real. Got it? So all, the moment you see the question is asking you to find nature of roots, all you need to do is calculate the value of D. That's exactly what we did here. We calculated the value of D. We have squares. We have 4Q squared and 4R squared as the answer. We know that these have to be, these cannot be negative basically. They have to be 0 or positive, which means D has to be greater than or equal to 0, which means 100% the roots are real, right? Greater than or equal to 0 means the graph is going to be either like this or like this. Right? And any one of these two graphs, roots are real. In this case, they are real and equal. In this case, they are real and distinct. We cannot be sure that they are going to be equal. That's why option C cannot be the answer. Right? We don't know whether it's 0 or greater than 0. That will depend on the value of Q and R. What we are sure about is that it will be greater than or equal to 0. Hence, option C. Question 7. Now, this is a flexible question. I told you at the end, right? There are going to be two types of questions that we'll have. Either fixed or flexible. I told you that two types of questions that we are going to have, either fixed or flexible. This question is of the flexible type. Why is it of the flexible type? The equation is not defined, right? A, B, C are all variables, right? A, B, C are all variables, which means what is a variable? A variable is defined as something which can take any value. That's the definition of a variable, right? You take any value and the equation should be satisfied. That means it is a variable. So, a variable is something which can take any value. So we can basically take any values of A, B, and C and solve this question. What will be the easiest values? Let me take A, B, C. Similarly, X, Y, Z, right? All of them are variables. So let me take A is equal to B is equal to C is 1 and X, Y, Z are also equal to 1. I'm basically taking everything is equal to 1, right? Because that satisfies this condition. Because I have 1 upon 1 is equal to 1 upon 1 is equal to 1 upon. Right, so whatever values you're substituting should satisfy the given question. So I can substitute these values. Then my question is to find out the value of this xy plus yz plus zx, right? So it'll be 1 into 1 plus 1 into 1 plus 1 into 1, which is 3, right? The value of this is going to be 3. Because this is 1 into 1, 1 into 1, and 1 into 1. Right? So the value of this is going to be 3, which means when I substitute this in my answer options, when I substitute ABC equal to 1 and XYZ equal to 1 in my answer options, I need to get my answer equal to 3. When I substitute this, I should get my answer equal to 3. Now in each answer option, substitute these values of XYZ ABC and check where you get the answer as 3. Wherever you don't get 3, you can eliminate that answer. See, that is the power of variable-based questions. You'll use this technique in all variable-based questions. Doesn't matter which topic. Across algebra, in algebra in general, you see X, Y, Z, A, B, C much more common than 1, 2, 3, right? So all of these questions are variable-based questions, which are nothing but flexible questions for us. Which means that when you're solving these questions in a multiple choice exam, you can just substitute any value and solve. You don't have to worry about solving this quadratic equation at all. Just take any values, because that is what a variable means, right? Any value of X you take, any value of Y and Z you take, it will necessarily give you the same answer. If it doesn't give you the same answer, the question is wrong. Now substitute in your answer options and check where you get the answer as 3. Because the answer should be 3, right? 1 plus 1 plus 1. This won't give you 3. right? This won't give you 3. This will give you 0, right? It'll become 1 minus 1. So this won't give you 3. This is giving you 3 squared minus 3. 9 minus 3 is 6. Not correct. This is giving you 3 minus 3, which is 0. Not correct. This is the only option which gives you 3, right? Because if you substitute, what will you get here? 1 plus 1 plus 1. The whole squared, which is 3 squared 9 divided by 1 square plus 1 square plus 1 square. So you will get 9 by 3, which is nothing but 3, which is the answer that we want. This is the method. We'll solve a few more variable based questions so that it will be completely clear. This is the method you'll use to solve all variable based questions. Basically, what we are doing is, in place of the variable that we have, we are substituting a number. And then the answer options are also in variables. Again, these numbers we'll substitute in the answer options. This is nothing but a variable to variable question. Because your question is in variables, answer options are also in variables. So this is a variable to variable question, which means in the question, you'll substitute numbers in place of the variable. Same thing in the answer option. In the answer option, the variables are there. Again, you'll substitute the numbers. And wherever it does not satisfy, wherever you don't get 3, you'll eliminate that answer. Wherever you don't get 3, you'll eliminate that answer. Got it? This is how we'll solve all flexible questions. We'll solve a few more flexible questions so that it'll be correct. See, the biggest advantage, you should not solve questions in a multiple choice exam the exact same way you would do them in a board exam, right? It's a waste of time. So wherever you see a flexible question, this is the biggest advantage you will have in an entrance exam, in a multiple choice paper, that in a flexible question, you will just substitute and solve. Otherwise, this would be a very long question to create a quadratic equation and then find out the answer. Right? We don't have to do any of that. A simple substitution gives us the answer. See, this question, again, similar. It's given that m and 2m square are the roots. So this is, again, a flexible question because m is a variable, right? M is a variable. That means it can take any value. It can take any value. So it's given m and 2m squared are the roots, right? X squared minus px plus q. Now you can take any value of m. Take easiest value. M is equal to 1 is easy, right? If you like 1, you take 1. If you like 2, still take 1. It's much easier to calculate, right? Point of substituting is to make calculations easier for us. So let me take M equal to 1. M equal to 1 means 1 and 2 are the roots of this equation. Right now I have P and Q. What is P? P is nothing but sum of roots. So it will be 1 plus 2, that is 3. Q is nothing but product of roots, right? Because sum of roots is going to be minus B by A. So it will be minus of minus P by 1, which is P. Q is product of roots, right? Which is going to be 1 into 2, which is 2. Because Q is product of roots is C by A, which is Q by 1, which is Q. That's it. That's all that you need to know. That's the biggest advantage in a variable-based question. All you really need to know about the topic is the very basics. This you'll know like within the first 5-10 minutes of quadratic equations, right? You already studied this in your previous classes. That sum of roots is going to be P and product of roots is going to be Q. That's it. Now for you, any question in P and Q is just a simple calculation using these two numbers, 3 and 2. Any question in P and Q is just a simple calculation using 3 and 2. So our question is Q plus 4Q squared plus 6PQ. Just substitute Q is 2. So it will be 2 plus 4 into 2 squared plus 6 into 3 into 2. That's it. This will give you 54. In your answer options, again, put in your answer options, substitute these two values, P equal to 3 and Q equal to 2, and check where you get the answer as this 54. When you substitute these two, check where you get the answer as 54. Right? So in option 1, if you substitute, what will you get the answer? Q squared. So you'll get 4. 4 is not 54, right? So we can eliminate option A. Let's look at option B. Option B, if you put P equal to 3, you'll get 3 cubed, which is 27, not 54. Eliminate. C is 0. Cannot be the answer. D will give you 54. Right? 2 into P cube will give you 2 into 27, which is 54. That's how you get option D as the correct answer. So basically, whenever you have a variable-based question, in place of variables, substitute numbers, right? Substitute simple numbers like 1 and 2, which make your calculations easy. So in this question, it's given that a function fx, let's draw it first, a quadratic function fx attains its maximum. Right? So is it going to be an upward facing parabola or downward facing? In an upward facing, you'll only have minima, right? Maximum is infinite. In a downward facing, you'll have the maximum, right? So it's not an upward facing parabola, it's a downward facing parabola. Great. So let's draw a downward facing parabola. Now it's given that the maximum value it attains, it is 3 at x is equal to 1. Correct? And at x is equal to 0, the value is 1. Question is to find out what is the value going to be at x is equal to 10. How will we solve this? See, it's nothing but 3 substitutions. The question is simply 3 substitutions, right? It's given that at x equal to 1, the value is 3. That means f of 1 is 3, correct? When x is 1, value of function is 3. Let's substitute that. Let's say the quadratic equation. This is basically a question of the type where there are some points given to us, right? In this case, there are 2 points given, right? 1 and 2. There are some points given to us and we basically need to find the function. Now, normally you need 3 points to find a curve, right? If you have 2 points, you can only draw a straight line. But here, 2 points are enough because this point is a special type of point, right? The point given to us, 3, this is a special type of point, right? This is the maxima. So this is a special type of point. That's why 2 points alone are enough. So the first point is f of 1 is 3, which is the first substitution we'll do. So if the quadratic equation is ax squared plus bx plus c, basically equation of this graph, we are taking it as ax squared plus bx plus c. Put f equal to 1, that means it will become a plus b plus c equal to 3, right? This is nothing but f of x, right? So in place of x, if you put 1 and equate it to 3, you will get a plus b plus c equal to 3. That's the first substitution. Second substitution, we know at x equal to 0, the value of function is 1, right? At x equal to 0, value of function is 1. So that means f of 0 is 1. So now in your f of x, put x equal to 0. So it will become 0 plus 0. So you'll get c equal to 1. Correct? You get c equal to 1. So value of c is known. If you put c equal to 1 back here, you will basically get a plus b is equal to 2. Right? You will get a plus b is equal to 2. Now we need to find a and b. What do you know about the minimum and maximum point? You know that this occurs at minus b by 2a, right? The minima or maxima occurs when x is minus b by 2a, which means this is occurring at x is equal to 1, right? Which means minus b by 2a is equal to 1, which means minus b is equal to 2a, or you can write plus b is equal to minus 2a. Substitute that here. In place of plus b, substitute minus 2a. So you will get a minus 2a equal to 2, which will give you a is minus 2, and hence b is 4. Right? That's your answer. Very simple. So it's basically nothing but 3 substitutions. F of 1 is 3, then f of 0 is 1, and finally minus b by 2a is 1. Right? Because you know minima or maxima occur at minus b by 2a. We know that, right? Which is why you got this. So you got this. Now you know what the quadratic equation is, right? Substitute this back in the quadratic equation. So now we know that equation of this curve is nothing but minus 2x squared plus 4x plus 1. Question is to find out value at x is equal to 10. That means the question is to find out value of f of 10. Right? So it's nothing but 3 substitutions to find the curve and then one more substitution to find the answer finally. Right? So the question is to find out the value of f of 10. So now f of 10, in place of x in this equation, substitute 10. So you will get minus 2 into 100 plus 4 into 10 plus 1. Right? So you will basically get minus 160 plus 1, which is minus 159. That's your answer. So it's nothing but 3 substitutions. F of 1, F of 0 and minus B by 2A. To get the equation, once you get the equation, question is to find out the value at x is equal to 10. You can substitute x equal to 10 and get the answer. Another way you could have gotten this equation is after you got a plus b equal to 2, the third condition. So this was the first, this was the second. These two are easy to use, right? We didn't have a third point, so we used this instead. Now, though a third point is not directly given, you can actually find out a third point on this parabola. You know that this parabola is perfectly symmetric about this axis, right? So if I have, this is 1, right? And this is 0. So if I take one more line at the same distance here, right? So this is 2. So that both these distances are equal, right? Both these distances are equal. I've taken one more line. What will the value of this be? This will also be 1, right? Because it's perfectly symmetric. Both of them will be the same value. So another substitution I could have done is f of 2 is equal to 1. Just as f of 0 is 1, f of 2 will also be 1. Because you know that the parabola is perfectly symmetric, right? Whatever value you get this side, same value you're going to get this side. If f of 0 is 1, then f of 2 will also be 1. Correct? Because they are equally spaced around the center. That's another way you could have done. Instead of taking minus b by 2a equal to 1, you could have taken f of 2 equal to 1. You will get the same answer. Either way, you can solve the question. So this is basically a question where points are given and you need to find out the equation. Right? The way we solve it is essentially graphically. Graphically is the easiest way to solve it. So again, nature of roots question. It's basically saying we'll cut x-axis at how many points. That means this is nothing but a nature of roots question. Whenever you are solving the question, the moment you read a question, categorize into what type of question. Is it values of x, in which case we'll use graph? Is it nature of roots, in which case we'll use d? Is it relation between roots and coefficients, in which case we'll use alpha plus beta, alpha minus beta, right? Or it's a direct question where you have to find the root of a quadratic equation, we'll use the quadratic formula. Right? Those are the four types of questions that we'll basically get. This is a nature of roots question. Nature of roots question means we need to use D. D is nothing but B squared minus 4AC. Right? For us, in this question, A is 1, B is minus 2, and C is 6. Right? The given question, just compare it to AX squared plus BX plus C. You will get A is 1, B is minus 2, C is 6. Once you have that, it's simple, right? B squared minus 4AC will be 4 minus 4 into 1 into 6, which is less than 0. Right? That means it cuts the x-axis at 0 points, right? Less than 0, d less than 0 means this is how your graph will look, correct? It cuts the x-axis at 0 points. No real roots. Basically, no real roots. That means this is how your graph will look. Does not cut the x-axis at any point.